Hey, hi. Very good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to the NVIDIA Expert Digital Workshop series. My name is Hubert Fernandez, and I take care of GPU initiative at E2E Networks. The topic for today's workshop is building AI solutions, conversation AI, recommender solution systems, IVA, healthcare, and life sciences use cases on NVIDIA accelerated computing platform using E2E Cloud. This session will be moderated by Mr. Unnikrishnan AR. He's the head developer ecosystem, NVIDIA Deep Learning Institute and CSP business for South Asia. So in between, if you guys have any queries or any questions, below you can see the Q&A button. You can click and post your questions there. In last, we have 30 minutes of Q&A session where we'll take all the questions together. So now I would like to invite Mr. Unni to take this session ahead. Yeah, Unni, over to you.
Thank you, Bert. Really appreciate you organizing this webinar and inviting us for this session. Good evening, all. Let me quickly start this session by sharing my screen. Hope you can see my screen now.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So thank you, Bert, again. We are very excited with having got E2E now fully onboarded as a local CSP. E2E has got all our underlying architecture enabled on their cloud platform. So it's really great to have a local CSP supporting us in the country, and it sort of completely democratizes the access on our platform for all of the country. Our intention today is to sort of do a workshop, not a pure format webinar, so that we can take the participants through components of how you can build AI solutions in focus area. Towards this, I have three of my colleagues, people who are actually hands-on working in these specific areas. You have seen them in the invite. They are also on screen. Most of them are showing their face to you on screen also, although I'm not able to see Pooja and Ashish's screen now. I have Ashish. Ashish, if you could put your camera on, I can introduce you properly. Ashish is a data scientist in our team. He is focusedly working on recommender systems as one of the technology areas which is of interest to him now. He'll be also talking about it. Next, I have Pooja. Pooja is a developer relationship data scientist in our team. She essentially helps onboard the ISVs who are working in focused areas of AI. Currently, she is focused on intelligent video analytics, and she'll also be talking about that topic today. And finally, I have Pallab. Pallab is handling multiple segments. He's closely working with many Indian customers also. He is focused actually on many areas, but currently he'll be talking about conversational AI in for today's topic. He'll also introduce us to our platform in detail so that it enables you to understand how you can leverage E2E Networks Cloud and build solutions on AI on our platform. So quickly to introduce NVIDIA to you, we pioneered accelerated computing to solve problems which is pretty much impossible for other computers to solve. This essentially enables us now in this era where we are in to cross over from a position where Moore's law is starting to end. And we are finding also in a position where AI is literally taking over everything that we are doing in life. And it definitely needs a compute environment which is 100x more than what we were anticipating earlier. So absolute right time for accelerated computing as a platform to establish itself. We had been on this journey for the last few years. And our platform is now available. Every cloud, every server manufacturer, is having NVIDIA as a platform available to you now. We are in more than 136 plus top 500 computers. NVIDIA platform is established. What we do is accelerate a domain. And once the acceleration is done, in that domain, then you take advantage of that by taking one processor, which essentially does the sequential part of the operation, and the NVIDIA GPU coprocessor, which does the parallel multi-threaded part of it. And then we take it domain by domain, accelerate in that domain. So currently we are there from everywhere to gaming, to data analytics, to life sciences, to full-fledged autonomous solutions on our platform, to the entire embedded computing recommender systems. So I've picked and chosen few of the areas which I think is the most critical, and we'll be talking about those platforms and explaining how you can build AI solutions on our platform in this workshop today. We'll try to make it as focused on that particular topic as possible, and then request you to come back to us for a detailed workshop as you find the relevant topic which is of interest for you. Now, accelerated computing as a platform is not just the chip. It is the full underlying stack which we build on top of it. And over the last 5-10 years now, we have been consistently delivering to you incremental SDKs supporting very focused specific areas. Just at this GTC, which we had concluded in last, I think, 10 days before, we announced 18 new SDKs. Our growth in our developer segment has also been amazing. We now have around 2.3 million plus developers worldwide. In India too, our growth has been substantial. We have almost 110,000 developers currently in the country itself. We also have 1,800 plus. These are the publicly available platforms which are accelerated, and over 6,500 plus startups who are very closely working with us as a part of our inception team. Now, coming back to our topic, right? AI has pretty much permeated our life as the most powerful technology force of our time. Few critical points which I wanted to focus on for this particular session, right? One is the underlying complexity of the network model is exploding. And you find that as a great thing, because your accuracy levels goes up, the problem which you're attempting can be solved now. But it also puts a constraint to you to ensure that the underlying infrastructure needed for you to meet the performance which you need or actuate the solution which you want is available. And that's where we come into play. And you look at what has happened over from just 2012, when the revolution started on the image side, to what is happening currently on the language side. It has exploded almost, right? The curve is an exponential curve. The petaflops per day has itself gone up from even on the language side, which started just in 2018, we are now seeing whatever happened in just last year almost revolutionized what is happening today. We are seeing that, you know, the language can now take us into the areas where we are able to do human level comprehension. We have chatbots which are almost talking like humans. Drone deliveries are now navigating on their own and reaching you with pretty much an accuracy which was totally not expected to be achievable in this time frame, even 2 years before. We are able to get into discovering vaccines and drug discoveries in time frames which was absolutely unimaginable earlier. The terrain capability of a robot from the way it was earlier, 5 years even before, to today what it is amazing, right? You're almost having a robot which can navigate terrain which is unimaginable for it to have achieved earlier. Our AI stack at this point of time is built on our underlying Magnum IO stack. And then you have our architectural framework of CUDA on top of it. And then the stack which is supporting the AI in the CUDA X libraries for supporting AI on top of it, the full-fledged containers to support you in specific domain areas. Of drug discovery, autonomous computing, conversational AI on top of it stacked for you. What I want to do today is to explain those stacks and explain how you can access them from our platform. In order to make this pretty easy for you, what we have looked at is the typical AI workflow in any of the development environment. If you take that workflow, it componentizes into training, where you take the data, take advantage of the right framework which your team is working on, train that network model which you've chosen for this function which you want to do, and then achieve a trained model. And then you deploy that into an inference environment with the new data which you want it to operate on, and then get the insights which you want. Now, in the training environment, you do this in either in a multi-cloud environment or on-prem or in a hybrid cloud environment. And in your inference environment at the edge, you would be either doing it on the edge devices or on a hybrid cloud environment. What we have enabled to you is on our platform, a stack of solutions which we are delivering to you over our NGC, the NVIDIA GPU cloud, which enables you to accelerate the time to solution on our platform. So it enables you to deploy the solution pretty fast by simplifying your development, enabling you to manage and securely manage the applications in a private registry if you want to do that, and then deploy it anywhere which you want in an NGC ready environment. So it is certified, it's supporting hybrid, it's cloud native, and enables you to take to solution wherever you want to deploy your AI solution. What I want to do now is to showcase to you how this can be achieved on NVIDIA platform on the E2E cloud. So I've Pallab here. Pallab, can you quickly show to them how we can do this, signing up on E2E and then taking them onto a particular area on NGC cloud?
Sure. Thanks, Unni, for setting up the context.
Perfect.
Let me start presenting my screen. Just give me a moment. Please let me know if my screen is visible.
Yeah, you are perfectly visible, Pallab.
Awesome. So let's go to ngc.nvidia.com. And when we go there, we have an option either to continue as guest, but to get the full advantage of using NGC, getting the intricacies of how the containers and all those important components inside NGC works, we would be logging in. So you can work along with me. You can go to ngc.nvidia.com. You can put in your email address over here, and you can register for free. Once you register, you can sign in with the same account and the credentials. You would be asked to verify the captures. So in this case, buses. And then we log on to see what is there inside NGC. Right. So NGC. NGC is basically, NGC stands for NVIDIA GPU Cloud, but don't get confused by the word cloud. It is basically a software hub. You can imagine it to be like a Play Store where all our optimized software stack is being housed, and it makes life easier for both developers as well as for infrastructure maintenance folks. In the enterprise or in startups to actually work and get their whole stack up quite easily. So so basically NGC, as I said, is our software hub. It houses all the different types of artifacts that you require for your algorithm development, be it in deep learning, machine learning, or even in high performance computing. You will be getting the complete optimized software stack to work on top of NVIDIA GPUs. So the intention is actually to make you get started with these quite quickly. And you as a developer only need to concentrate on how do you develop this, develop your own applications rather than fidgeting around and working with getting those libraries up and running, getting those compatibility issues through and all these things. So we have taken that pain. We have optimized them. We have a team who is responsible to do this. And we regularly update our artifacts that is housed inside NGC, so that you get the best performance available to work out of the box on top of your NVIDIA GPUs. So if you see, if you go to HGC, what you see on top is the different type of artifacts that we have housed in our software hub. So to start with, we have collections, right? So basically collections are use case based curated contents, as you can see over here, with respect to different, so we will be talking about the different software stacks. So with respect to different software stacks, we have collected them together in terms of use cases like recommender systems, image classification, speech recognition, healthcare, NLP in healthcare, image segmentation. Even there is one collection which says that how to get started with NGC. If you go inside this get started with NGC, you basically get the complete details of what NGC is. You get a couple of examples on how to get started with. We will run one of them in a short while. You get the complete details of what individual artifacts, as I was talking about, collections, containers, Helm charts, models, resources, and so on. And you also get the complete details of how to get how to set it up, how to get started, how to actually get your API keys, and so on. So this is primarily all about collections. Moving forward to the next tab, which is called as containers. Containers, so here you find all the optimized containers for different software stacks. So say, for example, if you want to work with a deep learning model based on TensorFlow. So you can just type on TensorFlow and you get many different outcomes out of it. So this, let us talk about the first one. So the first one is basically a TensorFlow container. It is a base container which is designed to run on a server GPU. Now, say for example, you might be aware of our embedded hardware platform as well, called as Jetson. Later on, we will be discussing about that as well. So if you want to run TensorFlow on a embedded platform, then this NVIDIA L40 stands for Linux for Tegra, which is the backend on which our Jetson hardware works. So you can download this container and then you can work on the embedded platform as well. So let's go inside this TensorFlow container. And if you go inside this, you get the Dockerpool command over here. So you can copy this Dockerpool command and you can be it wherever, if you are using your system, be it in cloud or on-premise or in your desktop, you can actually use this Dockerpool to pull the container and then get started working with it. So that's on the containers. Next, we move on to the Helm charts. So Helm charts are basically NVIDIA's catalog, which hosts the Kubernetes ready Helm charts, which makes it easy for you to deploy the third party softwares, right? So you can also take advantage of the private registry while you are doing so. Moving on to the next part, which is called as model. So what we have done is we have trained for thousands and thousands of hours. We have trained lots of models which are specific to use cases or specific to domains. Say, for example, if you're working with healthcare, traditionally, rather than working with a pre-trained model, which has been trained on top of an ImageNet computer vision data set, the amount of knowledge that you would be transferring when you are working with that kind of a pre-trained model on a healthcare domain is way less because it has been trained on natural images, right? So what we have done is we have trained healthcare specific models and we have hosted, we have trained them for thousands and thousands of hours on healthcare data. And that we have hosted on in our NGC model repositories. And you can start working with this. So there, if you go, you can search for different categories of data, different categories of models, be it detection, be it classification, even speech recognition models, your NLP models. All these different types of models are housed over here. Now we have talked about the models, right? But you also need a training script to get started. So for that, we have this resources tab, where if you go over here, then you will specifically get those those training scripts, which can easily help you in getting started with working with these pre-trained models using our containers, right? So let's say we go into one such. So this, if you see, it is a Transformer Excel model, which has been, which is trained for a language model, and it is trained on PyTorch, right? So you can see the date when it is created, you can see how long it has been updated, what kind of precisions that you can work with. You have the quick start guide over here, taking you through the complete examples, how you can reproduce, how you can use these training scripts on your own data set, and so on. So if you follow along these instructions, you will be easily able to start working with it. Now moving on, so these basically comprises of our NGC software stacks. Now what we also have is we have specific SDKs which are targeted towards explicit domains. Like say, for example, if you are working with intelligent video analytics, Pooja later on will talk about something called as Transfer Learning Toolkit and DeepStream. So all these SDKs are completely stitched pipelines, which helps you in getting your application to the market very easily. So they have a complete stitched pipelines, which then you can now choose which module inside this whole pipeline you explicitly want to work on, and rest of it is already available so that you actually spend your time in getting your application to the market on the specific innovation that you would like to introduce in that particular domain. So say, for example, if you want to work with DeepStream, you can just search for DeepStream, and here you will get a lot of different containers along with scripts, resources with which you can get started. So if you so DeepStream people detection model is one of the very popular artifact that we have in house in NGC. And if you go through this, you can easily deploy a complete intelligent video analytics to do people detection. So that's primarily on NGC. Now let's see that how easy it is to actually train a very small model on a cloud platform provided by Etui. So let's go to etuinetworks.com. Here we can sign up, and then once we have signed up, we can log in. And once we log in to our account, we can see different, so in the dashboard, we can see different matrices that are available. So I have a couple of resources already running over here. So I can, now let me show you how you can actually create your own virtual machine. So once we click on this create compute node, we have options on working with which virtual node. So let's go and start click on GPU. Here we have options of NVIDIA's latest and greatest GPUs. So we have Ampere architecture based A100 GPUs, which are available for you to start working with. These are our recent generation architecture based GPU, which you can easily spin off a container over here. You just choose what's best for you, click on create. And once you click on create, you can put in your SSH key, or you can just have the authentication with a password, either is fine. Give a default name, and then click on create my node. Okay, and then your node will get created. Now, once you go to the dashboard here, you will see a node has been created. Here you can see, like I have two instances which are already running. Now, once these instances are running, you can see you can see the statistics over here. You can go to the monitoring, the alerts, you can specify specific alerts. So here, this is the public IP. And once this instance gets running, you will be emailed the credentials to log into this public, log into this VM. You copy this public IP, you go to your favorite SSH client, you connect to that SSH client through that login credentials, and you will be logging onto the system. So let me show you. So I copied this, I go to this, I start a new session. SSH, paste it. Let me check my email for the password. So as simple as that, I am logged into the machine and it comes pre-installed with our drivers. So here we have CUDA 11 driver, CUDA 11 already installed with the driver 450, which is the latest driver, and we can get started working with this right away. It also comes with Docker pre-installed. So I can just check Docker images, and I have not, so here there is one Docker container which is already available, that is NVIDIA CUDA, right? So it's that easy to get started. Now let's circle back to NGC, right? So if you remember, I went to first, collections, and there I told you that there is this NVIDIA NGC getting started. There is this MNIST example. Let's click on it. This is an example which basically helps you in starting a in training a fashion MNIST use case. Right. So Fashion MNIST, as you all know, is a fashion data set which houses around 6,000 fashion data sets of different apparels. And if you go to this overview, you can actually download the artifact over here. Okay. So inside this, if you download, what you basically get is a file. This is the zip file. I downloaded the zip file. If you see, this is a wget command. With this wget command, you can download it directly onto your VM. Once you download it, you unzip it. So I unzipped it into a directory called as demo. And then I downloaded the Docker, TensorFlow Docker, because this is a TensorFlow one.
Actually, there is a request, Pallab, for you to zoom the screen a little bit.
Is this okay? Is the...
Yeah, I think it's better now.
It's better? Okay, awesome. Yeah. Okay, so now we are back onto NGC. Now what we need to do is we need to pull in the Docker container. So how do we pull in the Docker container? If you remember, the container is a TensorFlow container. Okay, so here we go to TensorFlow. As I said, we go to the we copy this. Once we copy this, we go to our instance. We go to our instance, we paste it, and we start pulling it. So this container is a bit heavy container. It takes some time to pull. As you can see, it will take a minute or two to pull. I have already pulled the container and I have already started a Jupyter notebook over here. As you can see, I have already started the Jupyter notebook with the Fashion MNIST notebook, right? So the notebook is like this. If you start this notebook, you get the detailed instructions inside the notebook on how the, yeah, so the detailed instruction on the notebook on how the how Docker engine is running, what exactly is So how the how to install the Docker, what NGC is here, exactly what I explained you till now about that same TensorFlow Docker. You can see it over here. This is how you run this particular command to start the Docker. And once you start the Docker, you can just do a pip install of JupyterLab, and then you can start a JupyterLab session using this. And once you start the session, go to your go to the IP. If remember, this is the IP which is of your VM with the port number at 8888. Right. So once I have this port number, once I connect to this port number, I can now get started with. So here there is a dependency on matplotlib and numpy. So I install the dependency. I run this code, and this code runs for 15 epoch, and it will take hardly 10 minutes to train this entire data set. And here, as you can see, we have finished training the data set. And this is the evaluation performance, and we are getting an out of the box evaluation of 88%. So this is how easy it is basically to get started working with NGC on a cloud VM or on your own desktop computers. Over to you, Unni.
No, perfect. Thank you. Pallab, you please stay online because the next topic is going to be yours only. Since this is going to be true for pretty much every use model which we are talking about, let me ask you one or two clarifying questions out here, right?
Sure.
So one is this is commercial, not commercial? I think you should clarify that point to everybody involved,
yes,
right?
Sure. So whatever is housed in NGC is completely free to use for your commercial applications as well. That includes the pre-trained models, the training scripts, the containers, and everything. So there is no separate commercial license.
So they can straight off go ahead and create an account here and start off.
Absolutely. It's as simple as that.
That's perfect. And can you also explain to them what's the difference between a native TensorFlow, let's say, framework and what's available in NGC?
Yes, it's a very good question, Unni. So what we have done is, as you can see, we talked about a TensorFlow container, right? Now, if you go to the TensorFlow container, if you go to layers, here you will see that inside these layers, we have a lot of NVIDIA-specific optimizations that we put in to the open source Git repository, which is available for TensorFlow. And this is same for PyTorch as well. So we fork the repository. We put in our NVIDIA magic to optimize it to work well out of the box on any NVIDIA GPUs. And then we put them with different tags. So say, for example, if you want to work with Python 3 on a TensorFlow 1, you have the option to do that. If you want to work with older variation of, say, a TensorFlow version, then you can go to the layers. You can see that. So let me give you an example. Say, for example, if you want to work with TensorFlow 1.15.0, exactly this TensorFlow version, then what we have done is we have kept on building the optimizations for individual releases of TensorFlow, and we have housed it over here as a containerized image.
So we're keeping the images of the older versions also and
yes,
optimizing the new versions as we continuously.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Pallab. So everybody, we are also announced in the last GTC that we are enabling all cloud service providers who are certifying with us on NGC so that you can have the same seamless experience on all cloud service providers which we have enabled with. We are very actively working with E2E to make this happen on E2E also. Otherwise, you can straight off now go ahead and deploy that into your systems as Pallab has shown. But once this happens, you, if you're an ISV, for example, you can onboard your market onto the E2E marketplace, your solutions, and offer that as a, in a monetization model. So this is great. Thank you, Pallab. I think we should now move to the first use case which we wanted to talk about, which is conversational AI, right? So language is our medium of communication. And I think the usage of that for anything that human beings do is pretty obvious to any one of us, right? We have built a full-fledged stack for supporting conversational AI built out by you. If you, whether you're an ISV who wants to build it, or whether you're an enterprise who wants to build that for your internal application purpose, or you are a solution provider currently having a solution and you want to plug that conversational AI piece into that. So Pallab, please take this up. Take them through what's the outlook currently in conversational AI. What are we doing out there, and how they can build a solution on the stack?
Perfect. Thank you, Unni. So thanks for the context. You have already set the context, and you have already explained that how important it is. And currently, I believe that this is one of the best time to work on conversational AI, because there have been a lot of innovations which have made this possible to surpass the human accuracy in both speech recognition as well as in the language modeling as well. So be it, it is transforming actually many different industries, be it video conferencing, call center applications, smart speakers, or retail assistants and in-car assistants as well. Specifically, I would like to talk about the retail assistant and the in-car assistant, because it is a bit different than the traditional conversational AI that we all are aware of, or that we all think of a conversational AI. A conversational AI, or when we do conversation, visual cues are very important. And it is very important to understand that in these kind of applications, like in the retail application, you can see that the lady is pointing onto a particular object and he or she might be asking a question like, what is the price of this item? So the assistant has to understand that the person is pointing at something. So it has to understand the gesture of the person as well. And going forward, it also has to understand that which object he or she is pointing at, and to get the relevant price of that or whatever is the query in speech, connect both of these cues together and then deliver a response. And deliver a response with a minimalistic latency to preserve the quality of service. So that's very important. And under this context, what we have done is we have developed this whole pipeline. So this is the pipeline for the audio to for a machine translation task. So say, for example, you have an input audio in a particular language and you need to convert it into another language. So these are the building blocks. On a top level, you can devise these building blocks as the speech recognition engine, the natural and language understanding engine, and then the text-to-speech conversion engine. So these three major engines have been combined together as services to be provided under this Jarvis. So you can build, train, and deploy this GPU-accelerated conversational AI system, which can enable you to fuse multimodal data. Multimodal, if you remember, both vision as well as speech, right? So what we basically would be trying to do is we need to enable this this entire process with different models, such that we achieve that low latency, which is very important, which is a key concept to actually meet a requirement of a conversational AI in terms of the quality of service. So under this different context, what we have done is we have assembled all these different conversational AI skills together into one umbrella. And as a user, you would be able to use these services and get to the market. As I said, the entire pipeline is stitched. You have an option either to choose, pick and choose which module you want to work with, and bring in your own innovation inside that. And then rest of it is already there. and then it makes it very easy for you to take it to the deployment. Right. So that's the whole whole value proposition of using Jarvis, because we all know that when we talk about these different types of models, like speech recognition model, natural language understanding model, as well as the text-to-speech synthesis models, these models are heavy. They are very difficult to train as well. Data is a concern. So you basically have a completely stitched pipeline to get, which can get you to the market very easily. That's one part of it. Now, say for example, if you want to develop your own model, as I said earlier in our NGC part, where you have all these pre-trained models. Say for example, you are trying to develop an application which is for hospitals and understanding different hospital lingos, right, or medical lingos. So we have specific models which are trained to understand those linguistic nuances of those domain-specific linguistic nuances, in fact. And then you can bring those pre-trained models, use your own data to fine-tune them, and then you can deploy them onto your application. So to fine-tune and to train this entire process, you can use Transfer Learning Toolkit. Transfer Learning Toolkit is basically, Pooja will take you through later on in details how to use it, what are those independent components inside them. But Transfer Learning Toolkit, as the name suggests, you bring in a pre-trained model, use your own data set, and fine-tune that pre-trained model for your specific use case. And that is what you can do without writing large lines of codes using Transfer Learning Toolkit. Now, as we were discussing, so what are these independent different services that you get, and how can you basically serve them? So you basically have the option to bring in your models into your existing, into this Jarvis platform. You can bring in, so we have already existing, that entire pipeline already stitched with the existing services like ASR, intent classification, pose estimation, facial landmark detection to understand the sentiments and all. So you have all these things, and these services have gRPC endpoints. So it is very easy to actually communicate these applications as a service to your clientele. And then you can run this using our Triton inference server, and you can deploy them on Kubernetes clusters with a single command line. So that's the power of Jarvis. So this entire thing has been packaged for you to very easily deploy it onto the deploy it as a service for your customers. Now, say for example, now if you want to build your own model, then how would you like to, you would like to understand that how can you do that, right? So for specific speech recognition, natural language processing, and for text to speech synthesis, we have a state of art deep learning based models which have been housed inside this library called as NeMo. So with this NeMo, you can actually build in your own models. You can fine tune your models with your custom data set very easily. This is completely open source. The GitHub link is given below over here. You can go to this GitHub link. There are endless different number of applications which are already there. If you remember, I talked about collections as well in NGC. So in NGC collections, NeMo is already available with a lot of different getting started material as well as pre-trained models. So you have the resource in, if you go to the resources, you will get the training scripts as well, which can help you very easily fine tune your data sets for this user specific, for your specific application. So these are interoperable with PyTorch and PyTorch Lightning. That's how we have built it. And currently it has built-in support for English and Mandarin as a language. Now with this, what kind of use cases that you can develop is basically, as I said, say visual diarization. This is an example which is this is a use case which is very common and very popular, where you basically need multimodal data, not only speech but also to understand who's speaking, about what context they are speaking. So the visual cues are very important to be combined together with the audio cues, and then do the whole summarization. Call center application is a very important application which combines both speech recognition and natural language understanding. It has it has its own challenges with respect to diversity of data, with respect to diversity in the languages, the accents, and the way we regularly speak within one another. And of course, the virtual assistant, which is the epitome of conversational AI system, which has made this whole thing really, very popular. So the end-to-end conversational AI system for this virtual AI assistant systems is available in Jarvis as use cases. Some inference benchmarks that we have run on SpeechQuad data sets are over here. I would not bore you with the exact numbers, but basically what we are trying to develop, as we said, it is very important to understand that we have to meet the human baseline of accuracies. But to do that, we just cannot rely on heavy and time-taking models. We have to get them done under a reasonable latency so that the quality of the service is delivered to the customer very well. And that's where you can see over here, less than 300 milliseconds of latency, which is near with a near human level accuracy using these existing models, basically Megatron and BERT model coming together to provide you with these with this kind of accuracy and performance is being delivered under Jarvis. Jarvis is currently available in open beta, so you can actually sign up for this beta program. The sign up links are over here. You can go over here, sign up, and then you can send us an email.
Probably, as well. Yeah. Pallab, you could enhance that screen and show that a little bit.
I don't.
Yeah, this is good.
Does this work? Yeah. It is not zooming any further.
Yeah, this is fine.
Yeah. So I think we can also put this in the chat to everyone. If possible, this link, so that people can go over there, sign up. You can, once you sign up, just put an email to myself and Unni, and we will take it forward and we will get you the early access.
Great. Thank you, Pallab. I think that gave a quick overview on what we're doing on conversational AI. You can poll the audience to see if they're interested for a detailed workshop. And based on that interest, we can probably organize one deeper workshop explaining each of the components involved in this and provide a little bit more hands-on experience. The idea out here was to give them a quick overview, and this is the same format which I want to follow up for the next of the sessions also. But before I let you go, Pallab, again, yes, one or two clarifying questions on this. I'll take the overall Q&A from the audience side a little bit later, but just quick clarification questions, right?
Yes.
And so can you give one or two examples where you think it immediately applies in the Indian context for our customers?
With Indian context, of course, as I mentioned in one of the slides, call center application is a huge application, specifically because if you see early this century, India was actually the BPO hub, and there were a lot of call centers that were there, and it is still now, there are a lot of call centers. So that's a very easy, or that I would say is the most promising sector. in India, commercially with respect to the business perspective as well, which I see will get revolutionized by conversational AI very soon.
Brilliant. Thank you. One more question, Balam, on the pre-trained model. What will be, in your opinion, the value for them? How are we helping them? What is the incremental proposition they get?
It's actually very very significant because, as I said, fine-tuning an application with a pre-trained model makes life of developers and the life of people who want to bring in some innovative product onto the market very easy in two folds. First, you require lesser amount of data to train. There is a lot of knowledge which we have already trained our pre-trained models with for thousands and thousands of hours in our GPU clusters. So that reduces that time, as well as it brings in lot of domain-specific nuances. It captures those domain-specific nuances, which you can then leverage in your application. That is first. Secondly, you basically do not need to, if you are using a pre-trained model, you do not need to train it for longer duration. You can actually, the closer your use case is to the pre-trained model, the lesser amount of training and that data set is required. So with these two aspects, I believe that having good pre-trained models, which are very closely representative of our use case, if we get that, that is nothing better than that.
And what we're doing in Jarvis is ensuring the best of that is available for the conversational AI piece.
Absolutely. That's the whole crux of this this product. Yeah.
Hey, thank you, Pallab. You stay online. I'll get into the next topic. So the next, just like conversational AI, the most critical piece now, which is out there for us to take advantage of with AI coming in, is basically it enables us to personalize the internet. And this will be as true for core-focused cloud-native web tech company, as well as for an enterprise, which now really needs to get closer to its customers. Recommenders is what will enable you to become make that personalization possible. We just like in the case of conversational AI, we have a stack which supports you for that and builds you use cases for recommendation systems on this. Ashish has been extensively working with on this field. And Ashish, you are there. Take it over, my friend.
Thank you, Ni, for the kind introduction. I hope all of you can see my screen. So the next minutes will be spent on learning about what are the things that we are doing in the era of recommendation systems. So the agenda for this.
Your voice is a little bit not clear. Could you speak into the mic a little bit? At least for me. So probably you can speak a little bit more clearer into the mic.
Is it better now?
Yeah, far better.
Okay, thank you. So the agenda for this session is first we look at what recommendation systems are at a very high level. Then we'll look at what are the challenges that people face while building recommendation systems and how you can use Merlin. Third component is to look at what are the different parts inside Merlin. And the fourth is we will look at some examples, some deep learning models that we can train via Merlin. So as Uni mentioned, recommendation systems basically help any internet provider company personalize the internet for their users. It could be any digital content, e-commerce, social media, or advertisement company, and many more companies which have a lot of user base on the internet and a lot of items that is shown to the users. And they try to find out some relation between the users and the items. It's also been reported by McKinsey in their 2018 report that about 35% of what users consume or purchase on Amazon.com is via recommendations, not via search, as well as 75% of movies what users watch on Netflix is also from recommendations, not from search. And hence, recommendation systems have become an integral part of every internet company to prevent users from churning and keep and engage the users more and more on their platform. The recommendation system pipeline is elaborated on this slide. The recommendation system pipeline would require a training data set. The training data set could be any amount of interactions that are happening on the platform. Interactions is anything that a consumer or a user is doing on the website or on the application. It could be clicking on an item or scrolling down. All of this gets recorded into the data lake, and hence a data lake is very big, up to a size of 1 exabyte. Once you have this data lake set up, to do a recommendation task, you typically extract some features, which is nothing but you build and take some columns out of this data lake, which would be representative of the user as well as the item. For example, you take out some features regarding the user, which is user's location, time at which the user is interacting with the platform. You also take some features with respect to the item. For example, you look at what movies did the user click on, what items did the user didn't click on. You take all these features and you, from about 1 exabyte, you come to about 10 petabytes of data. From these 10 petabytes of data, you do some pre-processing, as is very usual for any machine learning problem. You remove the outliers, you normalize the data set, you convert the categorical variables into dummy variables, and so on and so forth. Once you have done the data building pipeline, you would end up with about 100 terabytes of data set that can be used inside your frameworks for training a model. Typically, data scientists use scikit-learn for training ML models, as well as PyTorch and TensorFlow for training deep learning models. And once the model is trained, you export the weights of those models to serve it in an inference setting. Now, this whole pipeline has few bottlenecks on both building of the data set side, as well as on the model and hyperparameter tuning side. We will look at how Merlin solves both of these problems. So some challenges that we have seen our customers face while building these models are as follows. Since a recommendation problem typically deals with all the interactions on the platform, a typical data scientist works with GBs and TBs of data set. It takes about hours and days to feature engineer on these terabytes of data set. In fact, most of the times, feature engineering and data pre-processing takes more time than model training. Second, loading this data set into the memory and performing pre-processing itself takes a lot of time. Loading GBs and terabytes of CSV files or Parquet data set using Pandas or even Dask to perform data pre-processing takes quite some time. Third, when you are training a specific deep learning model which has embeddings inside them, the embedding size could easily not fit onto a GPU. Since the models that we'll be looking on are not themselves big, but the embedding tables of these models are big, we will look at why these embedding tables don't fit on GPUs. And lastly, the path to productionizing a recommendation model is not as straightforward as computer vision or any vision or LP model. The deployment for a recommendation system model is different, and hence building that deployment pipeline is complex for any data scientist. To solve these four problems, NVIDIA has come up with three frameworks. NVTabular is used to solve every problem around ETL, which is extract, transform, and load. So working on the data set for pre-processing as well as feature engineering can be accelerated on GPUs using NVTabular. Scaling the training onto GPUs is accelerated by another framework called as HuCTR. Even though you use PyTorch and TensorFlow for training the deep learning models. UCTR is another framework that we have developed, which will help you do data parallelism as well as model parallelism. Last but not least, for deployment, Triton Inference Server, which is very commonly used by many organizations to deploy any kind of model, is also tuned to deploy recommendation system models. Now let's look at each of these three components in a little bit detail. NVTabular, which is the recommendation system ETL on GPUs, helps you do feature engineering and pre-processing quickly and easily on terabytes of tabular data. Some of the advantages of using NVTabular is that it is not bound by the size of memory available on the CPU and the GPU, which means even if you have a single GPU of 32 gigabytes of RAM, you can still work on a data set which is more than 100 gigabytes of RAM. Second, it also provides you GPU acceleration. That means whatever pre-processing that you were doing with Pandas or Dask can now be accelerated. Third, NVTabular is a little more specific towards recommendation systems, feature engineering, and data pre-processing, which means that it's not a general purpose library as such. Thus, if you're building recommendation systems, it has all these operations and APIs that you would typically apply on a recommendation use case. And fourth, whatever data that you pre-process with NVTabular can be easily ingested into your common deep learning frameworks like PyTorch and TensorFlow, and it can also work with the framework UCTR that we are developing. When you move your RecSys pipeline from the traditional workflow to using NVTabular, this is how it will look like. NVTabular, as we just saw, works on the ETL side of the whole data training pipeline. So the building of the data set, which means engineering features, as well as pre-processing the data, and loading the data set into the model training framework like TensorFlow and PyTorch. Both of these paths are accelerated by NVTabular. The building of the data set part is more offline, which means it happens not on the fly, but the loading of the data set to the model training framework happens online. And hence, these two components have to be developed separately. NVTabular is also not just used while training. At the time of inference, when you're getting requests in real time from the platform, NVTabular can also be used to pre-process the data in real time so that you can do inferencing inside Triton Inference Server. Let's take a small case study to understand how fast ETL can be done with NVTabular. There's an example data set of Criteo. It's a 1 terabyte data set for ads prediction. This data set is very famously released on Kaggle and is famously used for any type of benchmarking activities for recommendation models. If you would be a data scientist who typically uses CPU for training their deep learning models, as well as ETL, you would be in the first category of users who uses NumPy and Pandas for ETL, plus PyTorch on CPU for training. To train a simple deep learning recommendation model with this software stack would take you about 7.5 days in total to get a model up to a decent accuracy. This particular model, it takes 5.5 days of ETL and 2.5 days worth of training. As you can see, ETL takes more time than training. If you have a GPU and you are aware of how to do data pre-processing and feature engineering with Spark, you would come into the second category of users. The second category of users still spend about 4 hours in total to get a decent accurate model. This type of users would spend about 3 hours on ETL and 1 hour on training, model training. this time itself is a little more high if you want to do hyperparameter tuning. Thus, if you want to get results faster, you should fall into the third category of users, which will use NVT Tabular and HeatCTR. Using both of these libraries, you can get a really accurate model in about 45, 41 minutes in total, which is 12 minutes of ETL and 30 minutes of training. And as you can see, with NVT Tabular, we have been successfully able to reduce the ETL time lesser than the training time. All of these examples and their scripts are available on the links below. Moving on from NVT Tabular, let's now look at the HeatCTR, which is a framework for training deep learning recommendation system models on GPU. As you know, there are famous popular frameworks like TensorFlow and PyTorch and MXNet, which are used for training any kind of models, be it vision, text, speech, or recommendation system. We still develop HeatCTR which is a highly efficient C++ GPU framework, dedicatedly to train recommendation systems. Because we realized that in recommendation systems, the problem is not the size of the neural network. The problem is the size of the embedding. And hence, HeatCTR supports model parallel embedding tables, which means you can distribute the embedding table across multiple nodes and across multiple GPUs. Since training the embeddings into a model parallelism fashion and training the neural networks in a data parallelism fashion is not trivial, hence HeatCTR provides you examples of training multiple type of deep learning models using this methodology. HeatCTR can also interact with NVT Tabular via the Parquet data reader, which means for any data set that you have pre-processed, you can ingest that for training in HeatCTR via Parquet. HeatCTR has many features, but here are some features which are highlighted. On the usability side of HeatCTR, even though it is written in C++ and we are working on developing Python wrappers, it helps you distribute the embedding tables to handle very large embedding sizes. By large, I mean embedding sizes of terabytes in storage. It has a flexible model configuration in JSON format, which means even if you're using a model which HeatCTR supports, like WidenD, DLRM, or NCF, and many others, you can change the layers and tune the neurons into each layer via the JSON format. It also allows you to dynamically insert features into the embedding without randomly initializing all the embedding. On the performance side, it does data pre-processing asynchronously, and it has accelerated libraries to do multi-node model parallelism and multi-node data parallelism. Some example recommendation model architectures that HeatCTR supports currently are on this slide. These are very famously used models by large organizations like Facebook, Google, Netflix, and others. And for each of these models, we have both the training, which is accelerated via NVT Tabular and HeatCTR, as well as inference, which is accelerated via NVT Tabular and Triton. So to take away for this whole session, Merlin is a framework for anything that relates to recommendation systems. Merlin is available in open beta as of now. That means you can access both NVT Tabular and HeatCTR on our GitHub repositories. NVT Tabular supports multi-GPUs and multi-nodes via Rapids VF and Dask framework. NVT Tabular also has APIs to ingest the pre-processed data dynamically into TensorFlow and PyTorch. That means you can you can pre-process the data and then create data loaders to train your models, even if you don't want to use huge CTR. And we are continuously adding more and more operations in NVIDIA Tabular. For huge CTR, we have just released support for DLRM, which is a deep learning recommendation model released by Facebook. And we have the code to reproduce our winning submission to MLPerf, which is the best performing submission on the leaderboard. We also have released the data reader to ingest packet files, as well as some performance enhancements done specifically for the Ampere architecture. If you are interested to learn more, feel free to go through the keynote, which is released about a month back. And there are two blogs that are released on both NVIDIA Tabular and Huge CTR. And if you want to have some coding examples, feel free to check out the Jupyter Notebooks on NVIDIA Tabular, as well as the Jupyter Notebooks for Huge CTR. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Ashish. Your voice was a little bit low. Please take care of that for the next session. In the meantime, probably one or two clarifying questions from my side on this. So one is on the interoperability with Pandas, NumPy, etc. So can you explain on that?
So yes, so as we know, NVIDIA Tabular is a little advanced for doing operations on GPUs, but not every operation is supported in NVIDIA Tabular. So there are times when you need to move front and back between NumPy and Pandas in between QDF and NVIDIA Tabular, which means that if you want to do some matplotlib kind of functions or some plotting on the data set that you have pre-processed via NVIDIA Tabular, you can easily convert a NVIDIA Tabular data frame or a pre-processed file to a Pandas data frame and then use it. Similarly, any array or any row and column in NVIDIA Tabular is represented as a CuPy array, which is a CUDA Python array. You can easily convert that CuPy array to a NumPy array to do any other type of pre-processing or any other operations that you want. So that means anything that you are doing in NVIDIA Tabular can be easily converted back and forth to NumPy as well as
between Pandas. NumPy and Pandas. Okay, perfect. One additional one on the huge CTR. What about training other models beyond the ones you talked about?
So huge CTR is currently supports about 6-7 models. For all these 6-7 models, you can tweak the model's architecture a little bit. Each of these 7 models are different. They serve different use case. And but you cannot introduce a new model in itself, which means you cannot build a new model in itself. You have to select the architecture and then you can tweak that architecture. What we have tried to do in HuCTR is cover approximately all the deep learning models which are popularly used for recommendation systems. And hence, if there's any model, deep learning model you think we have left out in HuCTR, feel free to raise an issue and we would consider it to add it to our next release.
Great. Thanks, Ashish. We'll cover this topic in detail. If people are interested, you please, we can collect the interest there and take workshop requests from there. Additional questions I'll ask you in the last. I wanted to stay back for covering the Clara Guardian and Clara Imaging. So everybody, the next topic which I wanted to take up is in the healthcare and life sciences part. Now, the value proposition that AI and combination of AI and HPC is delivering to healthcare is phenomenal. This, unlike the personalized internet, is actually helping us to personalize the medicine itself. It's also enabling us to discover drugs faster. It's enabling us to probably this time, very critically, enabling us to find a vaccine for COVID faster. It's helped in the entire value chain of COVID in tracking it, triaging it, and containing it, right? We have a full-fledged stack supporting drug discovery to genomics to medical imaging and creation of smart hospitals and medical instruments. Ashish will stay back to cover this. But Ashish, I want you to focus primarily on the medical imaging and the smart hospitals and medical instruments part, and then give an idea of what we are doing also in the drug discovery and genomics, and cover the first one, medical imaging and smart hospitals, a little bit more detail in interest of time. Ashish, your voice needs to be a little, probably you can speak a little bit more louder. A lot of requests on that part.
Is it better now?
Yeah, slightly there's a problem. I don't know whether, is it because you're speaking with...
I just switched my microphone. Hopefully this is better.
No, this is a little bit echoing, Ashish.
Oh. So, okay, I'll try.
Yeah, this is far better. Yeah, this is far better.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes. So I hope you all can see the screen again. So we are investing a lot into healthcare, and for healthcare, whatever we are doing is ingested into the NVIDIA Clara platform. So for the next 20 minutes, we will look into what NVIDIA Clara platform is made up of. As you know, healthcare is a very diverse field, and hence we have broken down this platform into sub-platforms. Platform for medical imaging, platform for smart hospitals, platform for computational genomics, and others. For this session, we'll focus more on medical imaging. That's where we have done a lot of part, and that's where the industry is adopting AI more. And then we'll look into Clara Guardian, which will focus on smart hospitals, which has gained a lot of traction since COVID. As a lot of things in hospitals are also becoming contactless. And lastly, we'll look into Clara Discovery, which will focus into computational genomics, which again has taken a lot of pace since COVID, as more and more scientists are working on genomics data to find the drugs specifically to cater to COVID. So there are three trends which is accelerating medical imaging, particularly. There have been a lot of research papers into the healthcare conferences, and about 70% of the research papers talk about applying any kind of deep learning model to medical images, be it CT, X-ray, or MRI, pathology, and other domains. And hence, medical imaging has taken up a huge boom in healthcare. Second is the IoT market, which is the sensors inside the hospitals, sensors in terms of motion detectors, cameras, IoT devices, which are used to monitor the patient. Those sensory data is also being used to do some predictive analytics. And third is the edge analytics inside the hospitals to do real time, to check real time monitoring of the patients and people who are inside the hospital. So these three trends we are seeing are being used for AI, and hence we're going to focus a little bit on these three trends. So first, NVIDIA Clara Imaging is the first platform that we developed right in 2018. This platform itself comprises of three components. I would say three SDKs: Clara Train SDK, which is to train medical imaging models. Medical imaging models for different type of organs, could be spleen, liver, brain, chest, and 20 other organs. Clara Train AIAA, which is an AI-assisted annotation toolkit, which is basically a toolkit that helps doctors and radiologists to annotate the data set. Because annotation of healthcare images is different than annotation of, a little different than the annotation of images in any other domain. And Clara Train also has training pipelines to easily do transfer learning in a deterministic fashion, do federated learning and auto ML for healthcare data set. The second SDK is Clara Deploy SDK, which will help you take these heavy models, generally 3D CNN models, and deploy it in a hospital setting, inside a hospital infrastructure. So a hospital infrastructure is very different than infrastructure in enterprise organizations or internet companies. And hence, we created a different SDK altogether, which allows you to do orchestration, monitoring of the services that you are running. It allows you to connect your deployment pipeline to hospitals, PACS viewer or storage, and so on and so forth. And lastly, there is another SDK that we are working on. We have not released it for general purpose use, but this SDK called as Clara AGX SDK will sit on the embedded device which NVIDIA is developing for the instrument manufacturers like GE, Siemens, and others. So whatever good things we are doing it for the data center in Clara Train and Clara Deploy can be extrapolated and applied on the embedded systems using Clara AGX. So now we'll look into each of these SDKs in a little more detail. So Clara Train SDK is a training SDK for training and transfer learning on medical imaging models. This SDK provides you with two sub-components. One component is the AI-assisted annotation, which provides you some pre-trained models for some organs that helps you do annotation in 3D. And Clara Train Framework, which is built on top of TensorFlow and PyTorch, which helps you do some very healthcare-specific image transformations, some very healthcare-specific loss functions and metrics. Plus, it also allows you to do federated learning as you know, because sharing of healthcare data is not allowed between hospitals. So it has a federated learning component as well as AutoML, which helps you perform multiple iterative experiments, multiple hyperparameter tuning in a distributed fashion, which was very difficult to do if you would have done it manually. For using both of these SDKs, both of these subcomponents in this SDK, we have released some pre-trained models for multiple organs, and we have released some pipelines of how to start a federated learning server, how to start a federated learning client, and so on and so forth. So typically the annotation part is, typically we have seen users consider data annotation in healthcare to be trivial, but providing a data annotation, providing an AI-assisted data annotation tool has helped the doctor's productivity by up to 10x. So data annotation in healthcare is very tedious because you have to look at the 3D volume of the organ, and then you have to slide in XY axis one by one, keeping the Z axis constant, and label that particular organ. So one 3D image itself takes more than 2 hours for a radiologist to label that particular organ in the medical image. And hence we have created segmentation and annotation models in AI assisted annotation tool, which means you can use this tool to automatically generate the segmentation map on the 3D image. And then it allows you to tweak that segmentation map and save that segmentation map onto the disk. In healthcare, each and every millimeter of annotation, of the organ annotation matters. And hence we allow the doctors to make those changes. The AI-assisted annotation tool can be used in 4 different open source medical imaging viewers: MITK, 3D Slicer, Fovea, OHIF. These are some These are the four medical imaging viewers that supports NVIDIA AI-assisted annotation toolkit. But if there's any other medical imaging viewer that is used by the doctor, we can help integrate the assisted annotation tool inside that. The AutoML featured in Clara Train helps you do hyperparameter tuning in an automated fashion. You would think that multiple hyperparameter tuning can be done by a data scientist themselves by running running a grid search or a training sweep on multiple hyperparameters. But that's a little non-trivial for healthcare. And hence, in Clara Train released AutoML, which takes care of any type of hyperparameter tuning, be it selecting the resolution size of the images, selecting the scaling size of the images, and so on and so forth. For federated learning, which is a very popular concept in healthcare due to the strict rules around sharing of patient data in between the hospitals. Federated learning is was a very important feature which was released early this year, and it's been very much used by hospitals around the world to train chest X-rays model to classify whether a chest X-ray is a X-ray corresponding to a COVID patient or a non-COVID patient. And hence we have seen that federated learning has helped a lot of customers build very robust AI models irrespective of the geography that particular hospital is in. And the process of training these models in a federated learning setting is very simple. There is a client-server architecture in which the hospitals with their own training model acts as client, and a central facility like NVIDIA or a healthcare institute acts as a server. All the transactions which happens between the clients and servers are encrypted, and the weights are privacy preserved. Now, after we have used Clara Train to train these medical imaging models, these models end up into the hospital's infrastructure to get finally deployed. These models are deployed into the data center of these hospitals or server rooms to be more layman. And they interact with the hospital storage, which is PACS, as well as the hospital's operating system and software that is used by the doctors to interact with patient data. To do that, Clara Deploy SDK is very much used as a middleman between the server as well as the doctor's computer to provide analytics as well as predictions. So Clara Deploy SDK is a reference application framework. It's not a SDK that you can deploy without any customization. It provides you many reference applications, applications like segmenting out a liver from a CT image, or reconstructing a liver from a CT image, and so on and so forth. The primary idea to deploy SDK is to cater to two type of developers: platform developers in the hospital or the healthcare institute, which basically works with the hospital's infrastructure. So for a platform developer, Clara Deploy SDK will help them interact or ingest the DICOM images, which is a common format in healthcare, input these DICOM images into the Clara platform, apply any deep learning model to do any predictions, showing the results of those predictions onto a user interface like Argo, managing the patient data on Argo, and scheduling multiple patient requests using Triton Inference Server, and then visualizing the output, visualizing the reconstructed liver, or visualizing the segmented tumor in the brain in a 3D setting using the rendering service. Those are the components that a platform developer can interact with in Clara Deploy SDK. And an application developer, which basically develops the end-to-end application, like CT liver segmentation or brain tumor segmentation from MRI. For them, Clara Deploy SDK consists of reference pipelines, which is nothing but a combination of multiple operations, which is read a DICOM, apply the deep learning network, write the DICOM, register the result of the deep learning model, load that DICOM onto the doctor's computer, and other things that application would want to have. So the Clara Deploy SDK also caters to the application developers by providing these reference applications. All of the Clara Deploy SDK is managed via Kubernetes, and hence you can see terms like pod manager, custom adapter, operations, because these are the terms which are commonly used in Kubernetes. So if you're interested, these are some resources on Claratrain SDK. There are some really good talks on GTC for each and every component of Claratrain SDK, be it train, deploy, AI-assisted annotation, federated learning, AutoML. So feel free to check out these talks on the GTC website. And similarly, we have some resources on the GTC website as well as on NGC for Clara Deploy SDK. So moving on from Clara Imaging to Clara Guardian, which is basically catering to the use cases in the smart hospitals. Use cases like body temperature screening, fall prevention of the patients, contactless control for the patients as well as the nurses and doctors, maintaining social distancing and so on and so forth. If you see, these use cases are not just image-based. These use cases uses multiple types of sensor inputs. For fall prevention, it could be a IoT input. For contactless control, this could be a speech input. For body temperature screening, could be a IR camera input. And hence, Clara Guardian is meant to cater to the use cases where you have multimodal type of inputs. So the Clara Guardian platform provides you with pre-trained models which can be used to build such use cases. For example, for a fall prevention use case, you would need a pose estimation model. For a contactless control use case, you would need a gesture recognition model, and so on and so forth. It provides you some training and inferencing pipelines using NVIDIA Fleet command, which basically works with multiple types of sensory input, as well as it also helps you deploy this whole thing onto an edge system or into the data center as well. Some sample pre-trained models in Clara's Guardian platform are on the screen. As you can see, wave gesture, two fingers left gesture. All these gesture models can be used by the patient to call a doctor or a nurse or ask for some help. And then there are some heart rate monitoring models as well as some face reduction and recognition models. So Clara Guardian is not just pre-trained models by NVIDIA, but it's also supported by a large ecosystem who is taking these pre-trained models as well as our NVIDIA Fleet command and building solutions on top of it. So Clara Guardian is primarily driven by our partner ecosystem, which could be healthcare solution providers, OEM partners, and system integrators who at the end work with these healthcare institutions and hospitals to deploy their solutions. This is a brief list of the partners we have in our Clara Guardian ecosystem. On the left are the names of some of the solution providers, and on the right is what solutions they have in public safety, patient care, as well as operational efficiency. And most of these startups are not based out of India, but we can definitely connect them to you if in case you need to deploy any such solution. So for Clara Train SDK, if you have some more for Clara Train, deploy Clara Guardian, if you have any more information required, you can visit these blogs. Clara Guardian is still in early access, so you can feel free to ask for access and we'll be happy to extend it to you. So the last topic for the session, I know Clara platform is very huge, but we just wanted to give you a glimpse of Clara Discovery as well, which is the computational genomics platform. Genomics is a complicated field, and we have seen researchers requesting for acceleration in the genomics field, especially to find the structure of the genomics, to find the genomes, how to simulate these genomes, and so on and so forth. And hence the Clara Discovery platform brings different initiatives that NVIDIA has led, be it initiatives around NLP or HPC and machine learning, data science, or Clara imaging. So the Clara Discovery platform is specifically meant for computational genomics, which means some HPC application, as well as for anything that relates to text on genomics. So we have released some NLP models for named entity recognition, as well as question and answers. The NLP model that we have released is BioMechatron, which is the state-of-the-art model to identify entities from public medical data. And we have also customized some machine learning operations for genomics as well. And lastly, for anything that pertains to genomics, the researchers would first need to read those genomics and sequence those genomics and analyze those genomes. GATK is a very popular tool which is used for sequencing of genomes, which runs on CPU, and Clara Parabix is accelerated GPU accelerated version of GATK, which supports many different sequencing operations, different algorithms for variance analysis, as well as pipelines for somatic analysis and other type of analysis that researchers typically do on genomes. So that's it about the Clara platform. Happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you, Ashish. Actually, I need to cover one more topic, so I'll reserve questions on this, even my clarifying questions to the end, and then we will come back to you. One core topic which is relevant today across any of the environments which we have is because of what is the revolution which has happened in the image. Video analytics is use cases is spreads across spectrum, right? From smart cities to safe cities, everything which you can think about, including your house, can take advantage of video analytics. We have a full platform which supports end-to-end enablement on that. And I wanted Pooja to cover this. So Pooja, over to you. I'm sorry we took a little bit of your time. So please go ahead.
Yes, thanks, Uni.
So Pooja, I'm hoping you will cover Transfer Learning Toolkit in a little bit more detail, because that'll apply for most of the other components also, right?
Right. Yes.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks.
Okay, so I would like to cover some basics of NVIDIA technologies in intelligent video analytics. NVIDIA per se focuses mainly on training a video analytics application, building the application, and finally deploying that application. And we have different architectures and pipelines specific to each of these functions. So the IVA market today is close to a $2 trillion industry with hundreds and hundreds of cameras bringing in data continuously. And all that data lying idle is not something anyone in any industry would get anything out of. So the main usage of all of these different camera feeds is to extract some useful insights and predict some kind of outcome so that that can be used for different industry segments like traffic management, retail analytics, automate processes in factories, handle warehouses and logistics, surveillance in stadiums and casinos, and to handle access control and air traffic management. So there is a variety of industry segments where video analytics finds its use, only because of millions of cameras which are all over the world bringing in video feeds that help you to get some kind of insight from those video feeds. So if you're a student or a startup or maybe a big enterprise organization, a typical, you know, set of challenges you would face while developing your own video analytics platform is mainly three things, right? One is creating highly accurate AI, and that mainly entails you building your video analytics model and making it a highly accurate model without, lessening the false positives and false negatives. The second part is achieving high throughput. Now, we are developing all these high accuracy models because we want this to run in real time. So if it has to run in real time, the alerts that are getting generated by those models have to be quick. So the models need to run with high throughput and lowest latency so that it's as close to the real event as possible. And third one, and the most common challenge that most of the organizations face is deploying at scale. So it's very easy to start, create a demo project and make it address each of these challenges. But when it comes to deploying at scale, so today you have one server where you're running all of these applications on, and tomorrow another server gets added because another 200 set of cameras are being added to your network. Your application that you have built should automatically scale to that other server and start running those models on that extra 200 cameras that you have added without your intervention. So you as an IP holder of the system shouldn't be required to support your deployment every time a new server or new set of cameras have been added to. So the technology that NVIDIA brings in aims to address each of these challenges and make sure that building your video analytics pipeline becomes easier and easier. And hence, time to market or time to develop and take that solution to the market is lessened. So one such stack or SDK we have for handling a highly scalable and something that addresses those challenges that we have seen is the NVIDIA Metropolis software stack. Metropolis software stack has, as seen in right at the top, has four different important SDKs part of the software stack. The first is the DeepStream SDK. Now, the DeepStream SDK looks at building your image processing pipeline, and then also helps you to look at the scaling factor of running your video analytics model. The second part is the TensorRT and the Triton Inference Server. These two SDKs focus on developing highly optimized deep learning models. Then we have the Transfer Learning Toolkit, as we have seen in several other SDKs that we have seen in Clara and with Xavier. Transfer Learning Toolkit basically helps you to train your own neural network model, but not just train your neural network model, but make sure that optimizing that trained model, which runs effectively on the inference side. So building that kind of a neural network model is what you get from the Transfer Learning Toolkit. And finally, the Video Codec SDK, which is one of the most important parts of the Metropolis software stack. We have the NVD code and NVN code functions that can be used to decode and encode your video streams on the GPU. And this is our own proprietary softwares that are used to run multiple video streams in parallel. And the entire Metropolis software stack can be either run on an edge device, an embedded device like the Jetson. We have something called Jetson set of GPUs, or it can be run on our data center cards like the Tesla T4. So a typical end-to-end video analytics architecture usually looks like this. So you have a bunch of video streams and information coming from different IoT sensors from the edge. And you have your data center where these video feeds that are coming in will access the trained models that you're pushing into the network. And then it will inference it will run inferencing on those trained models and then transfer some metadata into the cloud and then send it for visualization. So so the main part, if you're looking at starting to build your own, end-to-end video analytics architecture, the first thing you will start is by training your model. So first you select the model based on the use case that you want to do, the use case which you want to develop, and then you start by training that model. So now let's go into training a neural network model with the Transfer Learning Toolkit. So what is transfer learning? So transfer learning is a process of transferring learned features from one model to another. So transfer learning is basically it's basically done to train a neural network model accurately, but taking in less data. So if you have a pre-trained model, you can pick that pre-trained model and change the data set. Use the same set of pre-trained weights, change the data set, retrain that model, and send it for inferencing. Hence, your time to develop a neural network model reduces drastically. And since you will be, you don't need to build your own model from scratch, the cost of training a neural network model also comes down. So the Transfer Learning Toolkit basically consists of four different important functions. And the Transfer Learning Toolkit mostly entails of these four important functions. One is the pre-trained models. So from NVIDIA, we have built a set of pre-trained models for people recognition people counting, vehicle recognition, vehicle segmentation, etc. These set of pre-trained models can be used out of the box, and these are highly accurate pre-trained models. So you can pick any of these models and send it for inferencing, and you will be able to get a really a good set of accuracies for any of these models. If you need to improve that accuracy, you can embed your own data set to those pre-trained models, retrain it, and take those pre-trained weights and send it for inferencing. So the biggest value add from using a transfer learning toolkit is if you're looking at any of these basic use cases on the vehicle side or on the people side, you can start with the pre-trained models. The second part is we offer functionalities to perform data preparation and augmentation. So in order to clean the data and organize the data before sending it into the training of a model, there are certain functionalities that make it easier and faster for you to augment and prepare that data. The third part is training. Now, you can choose to train in order to reduce the model size for inferencing. You can choose to train your model in a lesser precision. For example, if you don't want to train your model in a single precision of FP32, you can choose to train your model in FP16. So that reduces, the model size and also reduces the time for inferencing and hence reducing latency. And the fourth part is pruning. The NVIDIA's transfer learning toolkit, have our own IP in how to prune a neural network model in order to reduce the memory size of very large models. So pruning is usually done when dealing with very large neural network models, which go from 80 layers to 150 layers. So based on the amount of latency you're looking at during inferencing, you prune a network based on if there are any layers in or any neurons in the layer which are not useful, you can prune those neurons out. Usually pruning is done in networks such as decision trees, but with NVIDIA Transfer Learning SDK, you need not choose which neuron to be pruned. We have our own technology which makes that decision for you, so it chooses on its own which of the neurons are not useful and which do not impact on the accuracy, and those neurons are pruned, hence reducing the size of the model. So the transfer learning toolkit's key features are as given. So one is obviously the model pruning, what we saw. Second is quantization-aware training, which is basically improving the accuracy if you're looking at inferencing on a 127-bit scale instead of FP32, which is a wide range of data set, right? Because you're dealing at 10 power minus 32 to 10 power 32, which is a huge set of parameters. So you can choose to train your model to just 127 bits, but handle the accuracy so that the accuracy doesn't drop. The third feature is deployment with DeepStream. So Transfer Learning Toolkit integrates automatically to DeepStream. There are certain plugins that you can use to directly pull your model from TLD and inference or deploy on the DeepStream SDK. Third is speeding up training time using multi-GPU training. So there are certain functionalities that you can use from TLD to train on multiple GPUs and also share GPU parameters for your different neural network models. The fourth is automated mixed precision. So here you can again, in quantization-aware training, you can choose to train your model in FP32 or FP from FP32 to FP16 or INT8. But the advantage of using automated mixed precision is that your model will now train on something called a tensor core instead of CUDA cores. So a lot of our NVIDIA GPUs have our own optimized architecture called tensor cores, which are used to run these vector vector multiplications or vector operations. So your training will run on these specialized tensor cores, hence improving the training time. And finally, there are certain set of features that you can use for data augmentation in terms of, you know, spatial augmentation, changing color, changing orientation, etc. Now, let us briefly look at how Transfer Learning Toolkit performs, model pruning. So basically, it's a very simple two-step process. The model pruning first reduces the model size, and you need to incrementally retrain the model after pruning to recover that loss of accuracy. So for example, if you look at this image, there are, you know, six inputs, and there are six neurons and 32 different connections. So imagine the number of parameters that are hyperparameters that are going to be output from these two, in fact, not even from these two neurons, but right from the first set of neurons. The set of hyperparameters that your model is dealing with is huge. So in order to lessen the time to train, as well as reduce the memory size, you can choose to prune certain neurons so that those connections are reduced, and hence you're reducing the hyperparameters as well. So the process of reducing this neuron, so in a usual decision tree kind of algorithm, you go step by step. In each tree, in each branch, you have this yes or no decision. And based on following that graph, you decide which neuron to prune. So here, you don't need to go in detail. You don't need to make that decision. We have our own IP where the Transfer Learning Toolkit automatically decides which of the neurons in your model has least impact to your accuracy, and it makes that decision of pruning that model for you. So the moment the couple of neurons are pruned, the hyperparameters drastically reduce, and also reduce the size of your neural network model, because if your model size is huge, then that adds to the latency while you're running this model during inferencing. So if you look at, on the right side, a ResNet 18 kind of model, an unpruned network usually has a very large, network size, whereas a pruned network using Transfer Learning Toolkit reduces the network size by 6.5 times, size reduction. And this in turn impacts on your throughput while inferencing. So since the model size is very small, your throughput increases by 2x. So now let's go towards quantization-aware training. Quantization-aware training can be performed to, again, reduce the model size, but also to train your neural network model not on, a full precision 32 bits, but either in FP16, that is full precision 16 bits, or 127 bits, which is INT8. Now, there are certain ways quantization can be done. Because imagine your full precision data range is as shown in the line here. And when you're drastically reducing it to a 127-bit data range, a lot of these different data points get lost. And if you randomly, squish those data points, you might lose out on the accuracy because you don't know which data point impacts to your accuracy. So in order to avoid losing accuracy, we have our own set of IP to make sure that you don't lose out on accuracy. And there is a process that that follows in order to, you know, that will enable you to train on 127 bits while maintaining that accuracy. So what you can do to perform a quantization, you know, aware training using Transfer Learning Toolkit is first train the model, and then you can use the prune function of the TLT, prune the network, and then you need to retrain, obviously, because if once you are pruned, it will impact on that accuracy, right? So you need to retrain with the new set of neurons, reduced set of neurons that you have. So when you retrain with quantization aware training. So instead of FP32, you're now going to retrain with INT8 and then export that that pruned model and send it for inferencing. So there are two ways you can choose to do, quantization, right? One is during training, that's what we are proposing here. And then you can also do quantization post-training. So the advantage of doing quantization during training is what we would like to show here. In order to avoid drop in accuracy, which you might face when you're doing quantization post-training, will be avoided if you're doing quantization, while training. So you can see that on a baseline FP32, the accuracy, if it's somewhere around mean average precision is somewhere around 78.37. If you're converting it into INT8, you're still maintaining that precision. But if you're doing post-training quantization, then that precision drops. It is always advised to do quantization while training your network or while retraining your prune model. Another feature, as we looked at, that Transfer Learning Toolkit offers is the automatic mix precision. Now, this kind of goes hand in hand with with the quantization aware training. But the difference here is that when you choose to train your model in FP16 or INT8, the training of the model will run on tensor cores instead of CUDA cores. So running on tensor cores will drastically speed up your math intensive, vector multiplication operations. And it also speeds up, memory intensive operations by using half the bytes and thus, overall reduce the memory requirements. So if you see in general, training time when comparing running in a ResNet 18 model in FP32 versus running in, automated mixed precision mode, there is a 1.5 times speed up. So the quantization aware training and AMP kind of go hand in hand. If your underlying hardware has tensor cores, your underlying NVIDIA hardware, then you can use AMP to run or train those model on the tensor cores. Now coming to, I would say the most interesting part of the Transfer Learning Toolkit is the purpose-built pre-trained models that we have, build and that is open to use for everyone. These are highly accurate, retrainable, out-of-the-box deployment models. You can pick any of these models. So PeopleNet detects people in a generic environment. There is a traffic cam net. So this is usually, for a CCTV kind of cameras, which is looking at a traffic junction to detect the number of vehicles. And then you have the dash cam net. So if you're working something on automated, an ADAS machine, automated driver assistance systems, you will have a dashboard camera that's looking into the oncoming traffic. So the dash cam net again has four different classes. It's going to recognize oncoming vehicles. It recognizes road lanes and also trees and people on the road. Then there is vehicle type net, so you can recognize between buses to cars. But mind you, these are not trained specifically for Indian conditions. So two-wheelers are not included in this, but you can detect different kind of vehicles. And then you can also run vehicle make net that we have built. So you can identify what is the make of the vehicle. Is it an Audi or a BMW? Is it a sedan or a hatchback kind of classification? And we have also built a phase detection model, but it runs on an IR image. So in this time of pandemic, where a lot of people are working on temperature detection on infrared images, or mass detection on infrared images, they can use the phase detect IR out of the box. Now, the below block here kind of shows what is the accuracy that we offer for each of these models. These are all, you know, you can just pick this model and send it for inferencing, and you will be able to get, you know, 85% accuracy. But if it is specific to certain conditions, we advise you to retrain on using your own data set, and it will still give you the same or better accuracy. These are just some kind of, you know, FPS numbers that I wanted to show you for all these different model architecture that we have given. This table kind of shows what is the FPS you can achieve with a different set of you know, GPUs that we have in our ecosystem. So if you're looking at an embedded GPU box, these are the FPS that you can achieve. And on a T4, which is more of a server grade card, you will get much higher FPS. And anyone who is developing on any of these, you know, embedded boxes or T4 cards can use this as a reference while using our pre-trained models. So here's a short demo of the people counting that's built on the PeopleNet model. Now you can also take the PeopleNet model, make small changes to run it as a social distancing application as well. So this is, you know, a ready to use application that you can run. So in this time of the pandemic, where a face mask detection has become imperative in any kind of public place, we have released a complete code with the Jupyter Notebook and steps on how to build your own face mask detection. We also have a developer blog and a GitHub repo that gives you know, how to build your own, you know, face mask detection algorithm. This is, again, we have built this making small changes on our PeopleNet model. So this can be used out of the box, and you can you know, run this application anywhere, you know, like hospitals or workspaces or traffic junctions, stadiums, etc. So I would suggest you, anyone who's looking for these kind of solutions, you can go to our developer blog or GitHub repo and run the face mask detection application. Now, we've looked at, you know, training a neural network model. Now let's look at building that image processing pipeline and deploying that video analytics architecture. So a typical, you know, IVA application workflow on the inferencing side looks like this. So you have these different IoT sensors and which are sending the streams to a device which would have its own GPU. And we usually call this an edge device because pulling the camera streams all the way to the data center, you know, there's a lot of bandwidth and there could be drop in bitrate. So you'll have an edge device, which could be a T4 or any of our embedded boards. What you usually do is you capture the image stream, you do some kind of pre-process on it, and you do simple applications like detecting and tracking on the edge itself. Once this is done, you transfer that metadata into the cloud to do then, you know, further post-processing and analytics and visualization, etc. Now let's see how DeepStream can be used to build this entire workflow. The DeepStream software stack basically looks like this. And it again has four main components as part of it. The first one is hardware accelerated plugins. So the most important part in building a video analytics pipeline is you look at reducing latency, because decoding a video stream continuously brings a lot of impact on your video analytics pipeline. So you need some hardware accelerated plugins, which are going to plug into your image processing pipeline and decode them as soon as possible. And this especially matters when you're looking at multiple streams. The second part is bidirectional IoT messaging. Now, this is very important because as we saw in the previous slide, metadata that you're going to be collected on the edge, you're going to send it into the cloud to perform recognition or any kind of post-processing or even to generate alerts. Now, to send those metadata into the cloud, if it is a single directional IoT messaging protocol, the cloud has to keep pinging the edge device continuously to see whether it has an alert. Does it have something to send? Does it have something to send? So this becomes, this is draining on both the cloud architecture and the edge device and takes up a lot of bandwidth. What the bidirectional IoT messaging entails is the cloud doesn't need to ping the edge device continuously, but when there is an alert ready at the edge, it automatically sends to the cloud. So we have that plugin as part of DeepStream. The third is OTA model update. So for anyone who is looking at developing multiple video analytics platform and deploying at the edge or at customer place, you will need to keep sending upgrades or updates to your application. So on the air model update is enabled. So you can just use this plugin to send any kind of updates to your applications in the future. And the fourth part is reference application and Helm charts. As part of DeepStream SDK, Pallab showed in his session, you can go to NGC, download the DeepStream container, and we have a set of 10 different reference applications that can help you get started. And all of these reference applications and Helm charts mostly is looking at building your own orchestration platform. If you need to develop something as a video analytics, a SaaS-based model. We have certain functions to help build that orchestration platform as well as part of DeepStream. So let me just briefly take you through the DeepStream architecture end to end. The main-
Pooja, I think you need to go a little bit faster. We really ran out of time.
Sure. So quickly, DeepStream follows this graph architecture where you can use any of these blocks individually to perform any of these operations. And one thing you need to keep in mind, what DeepStream offers is decode using the NV decode, our own decoding plugin, which will allow you to decode on the GPU. Again, image processing, if you want to scale, dewarp, or crop, this will also again run on the GPU. We have our own IP of batching, a stream management batching algorithm that will help you to manage multiple streams. So this is our own IP. You can use that as part of DeepStream as well. For detect, classify, and segment, this is where your model that you have trained from Transfer Learning Toolkit gets plugged in. And this again runs on the GPU. If you want to perform tracking, that again runs on the GPU. And even visualization runs on the GPU. So being a graph architecture, you can take out any of these at any point of time or use the end-to-end architecture as shown here. So we have seen the all of the key features of DeepStream, but some of the other things that we didn't cover was developing in Python. So DeepStream is actually natively built on C++, but to target the Python community, we have developed Python wrappers. So you don't need to go the C++ route to develop your own applications. We have also launched support for Red Hat. So for people who are working on Red Hat, it's useful. And DeepStream is also integrated with Triton Inference Server. So the Triton Inference Server is mostly helps you to kind of build a ready-made inference server to run your model at scale. And this inference server is better preferred over TensorRT. So TensorRT is our own deep learning optimization engine, which optimizes your neural network for inferencing. Now TensorRT also plugs into Triton Inference Server. So Triton Inference Server basically offers higher flexibility in terms of deploying your model at multiple locations. This is just, so let me quickly show you these different FPS that you can achieve in using different NVIDIA hardwares. So if you're working on any of these NVIDIA GPUs, you can use these as reference that you will be able to achieve using DeepStream. So to summarize, you can train with the transfer learning toolkit. You can build your own image processing pipeline with DeepStream using the graph architecture, and finally deploy it using our Helm charts and the Triton Inference Server to deploy at scale. So you can, so these are some links for you to get started with. These are all the blogs and documentation and sample codes that are given here. And I hope this was beneficial for you to develop your own end-to-end video analytics pipeline. Thank you.
Thanks, Pooja. Appreciate it. I think we a little bit overshot our time. We're on 20 minutes late. What I wanted to do quickly was to show a few things which we wanted the audience to participate in, and then take one or two questions if possible, if time permits. Let me share my screen and quickly show you this. So we wanted your input on this. This is a survey which we're doing along with E2E. The link is here. I can post this into the chat window. This is a request where we are making and to understand your data science pipeline currently. We are end-to-end accelerating the data science pipeline, and we're doing a survey to understand your environment so that we can come back to you with a value proposition. It's a survey which is available online from E2E's site. Do register here, download. We are giving you an ebook on how you can accelerate Spark on GPU pipeline. That's one thing which I wanted to showcase to you and tell. If you're interested in looking at creating a GPU environment virtually for either a workstation application or a computer application, we are currently offering you a test drive on the E2E platform to see how you can take advantage of that immediately. Again, the link is available. I'll show both of them into the chat window for you to take advantage of. Other than this, Pooja, one clarifying question I wanted to take to you with you first before I sort of try and take some of the audience questions. On the Metropolis stack, are we offering any certification? How does a IVA, ISV, or rather somebody who wants to develop a software environment on our stack get into a certified mode from our side?
Okay, so we do have our own certification that we offer. It's called the Metropolis Software Certification Program. This is basically for different software vendors. All they need to do to get their application certified by NVIDIA is to containerize their application, and we then give them access to our own Metropolis Metropolis lab, where they can, with an entire set of T4 server with all the components and data set required, they can just run that application there and get certified as a software certified partner from NVIDIA.
Okay. And do we have any website or something which you can quickly share to?
Sure. Yeah. I'll share this in the window, chat window.
Yeah. And Pallab, probably you could explain, I know that all the containers which we talked about are available in NGC currently or not?
Yes, all these containers are available in NGC.
Okay. And you have already showcased to them how you can pull this from. On the jar, you also showed the early access on Jarvis.
Yes, I have shown the so the link is I will put the link in the chat.
One more
request to everyone is that once they apply for the or sign up for the early access, please do write an email to myself and Unni. I will put the email IDs as well in the chat so that we can proceed with that early access request faster.
Ashish, I think one question I'd missed out with you was, you know, what are the type of data formats that NVTubular supports? Many people might be interested in that given this is.
So NVTubular can read data set in the formats of comma separated values, which is CSV files, and Parquet files, HDFI files, and it is accelerated to write the processed data set in the Parquet format so that it can be used in any framework.
Right. One additional question was there on the this is actually from the audience, on the federated learning, do we have it in production currently?
So there has been during COVID itself, somewhere about in March, we released federated learning in Clara Train. And during these times, we have there are about handful of 8 to 10 institutions who are participating into training a CT model for COVID classification. That means it is in production, being used by healthcare institutes and hospitals, and the process is smooth. And there are healthcare institutions which are using it in production.
And I think, you know, this is a great model for India, particularly, right? With the you know, type of data security which we are asking, the legal issues involved here, this enables you to tightly control that environment, ensure that the work happens also parallelly, and full-fledged collaboration across various hospitals which is out here, right? Pooja, one thing I think you need to clarify on TLT is, can people bring their own models and leverage that?
No. If you want to use, no third-party pre-trained models are supported by Transfer Learning Toolkit. What you can do is use any of our, own pre-trained models. And this is in terms of pre-trained models per se. But if you want to bring your own model to use pruning or quantization-aware training, all of that can be done. But in terms of pre-trained model, you will only have to use the pre-trained models that we provide.
Okay, what about support for segmentation?
Yes, so we do have, we support instance segmentation with mask RCNN architecture. This is currently supported. We also have a blog for that. I'll share that blog poster in the chat.
Perfect. I think we should close this now. We already taken almost 26 minutes extra of the time. Thank you, everybody. Really appreciate your support on this. We are living in very exciting times. And I think we have a platform which is ready to take on the challenges which is there. Full-fledged availability of this platform is available from E2E Cloud now. They have enabled all our latest architectures. And please call on us for a detailed workshop on any of the topics which we discussed. Thank you very much. Till next time. See you. Hubert, I think you can take over and close the session. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Omni. Thanks, Ashish. Thanks, Vallabh. Thanks, Pooja. It was a pleasure having you guys in our session. So thank you very much, audience. Also, we'll be conducting more such workshop with NVIDIA team, and we look forward for more events and workshop. Thank you and have a nice weekend. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.